let's now go to the exports.
Section 243 defines export of goods with its grammatical variation and cognate expressions means taking out of India to a place outside India.
Full stop. A very restrictive definition of exports. Exports means taking of goods from India to a place outside India. As of today, what happens is there are lots of concessions for deemed exports. So if I am a manufacturer, I supply goods to a trader who in turn exports it. Then I can obtain, sell the goods to him against what is known as an H form. So he will not, I will not charge him CST, and he will export the goods, he will give me his bill of lading, and that bill of lading is sufficient to take care of my tax liability. I don't have to pay any tax as of today. That concept of penalty made sale is going away in GST. There is no form, therefore if you are directly exporting, no GST. If you are exporting to, if you are supplying to a trader who in turn exports, then you will charge GST to the trader. Trader will claim a credit and a refund. He will not be zero rated. He will have to pay the tax and then claim the refund. Okay? So that is one part to it. Same thing in excise. Today we have CT3 and ARE1. So the customer will give me the CT3 and ARE1 bonding will be done. There will be a proof of exports wherein the debonding would happen. And accordingly, once all those documents are done, I don't need to pay excise duty even if I am not directly exporting, but exporting to a merchant exporter. All those concepts go away, and therefore you will have a GST implication at that end. So manufacturer directly to the buyer will be an export. You supplying to a trader will not be an export. H form and ARE1 process becomes redundant. As far as the trader is concerned, when he exports, he gets an exemption and a zero rating, and accordingly he will have to first pay duty to manufacturer and then claim a refund. So this is one important area where we will see a lot of working capital blockage. And when I'm on this point, I also need to highlight that today there are lots of other deemed exports. You have supplies to SEZs, supplies to EOUs, STPs, HTPs, all of them are treated as deemed exports, and as a manufacturer, you are not required to pay excise duty on all these transactions. All of that is likely to go away in the future, and you will have a GST implication on each of these transactions. Those people will then claim a refund from the government. That is what they are saying. We don't, because the whole idea of GST is we want to make it a document, non-document driven law. Today there's lots of documentation and we want to avoid all those documentation. And the only way we can avoid a documentation is by prescribing a tax. And that's what we are doing. We are saying we'll have a tax, and that person who wants the concession will get a refund from the government in an appropriate manner. Export of service? Any questions? That's the problem, and that's one of the trust deficits which happens. We are talking about government not giving you. Between the governments also, they don't give each other. In fact, few years back when the CST compensation package was announced, it took 3 years for the central to give that CST compensation to Gujarat. In fact, before the BJP government came into power, Gujarat was one of the foremost opponents to GST. And one of the reasons which they always cited was, the center says I'll give you, but you never give us. You always give me a stepmotherly treatment. You gave the CST compensation to some states, you didn't give us on one pretext or the other. So that is a challenge, you know. Governments will find all excuses not to give you the refund. And I'm aware that in income tax also this year, in the last month, they said we want to give refund. But what SO officers used to do was, whatever is the refund amount, same amount they used to put in interest and make a zero order and give you. And then they say that now you come ahead next month and ask for rectification. This month I don't have funds to give you. So I have to pass an order before 31st March. So that issue is there, and we'll have to, you know, this is a mindset issue. These are all mindset related issues.
Sir, but that brings me to question. GST, is there a provision for a timeline in refund?
Yes, so they have talked about filing a refund claim and giving you the refund within a couple of years. But we have also seen that whenever there are timelines imposed on an assessing officer, they are counterproductive. As consultants, as professionals, we've seen that they are counterproductive. So what happens is, when they say, even internally they say that you have to process the refund within 1 year, and if their mindset is not to give you a refund, they will find some reason or excuse to reject it. And on at the flimsiest reason, they will reject it. And that is what is happening. Even, you know, assessments, when you have an outer timeline, many times you see a high pitched assessment happening on the last date because assessment has to happen on this day. So if 31st March is your cutoff for scrutiny, on 29th they will ask you 10 details, and then when you are not able to submit it, they will say SSC didn't submit it, therefore I am passing an order to the best of my judgment. So that is a challenge which we see in prescribing too much of an outer timeline. It does not work. It mostly all of these are mindset related changes, and I think that will take at least 2 decades to change. And I'm not sure whether it will happen even after that.
Section 244 defines export of service. The supply of any service shall be treated as export of service when A. The supplier of service is located in India. B. The recipient of service is located outside India. C. The place of supply of service is outside India. D. The payment for such service has been received by the supplier of service in convertible foreign exchange. And E. The supplier of service and the recipient of service are not merely establishment of a distinct person. Explanation: for the purpose of clause E, an establishment of a person in India and any of its other establishment outside India shall be treated as establishment of distinct persons.
So if you look at it, today we have rule 6A of service tax rules, which defines an export of service. And if you compare that definition with this definition of export of service, you'll find that it is more or less similar. And therefore, I don't see a major challenge in this area. Only area is clause C, the place of supply of service is outside India. Now, that is where we will find some interesting advantages as well as challenges. Today, we have a place of provision of service rules, which has various tests. Rule 3 all the way up to rule 10, and different rules have been laid down. Something similar is mentioned for the place of supply for services under the new regime also. But in that, there are opportunities as well as challenges. There are changes in rules, and based on that, my export, which today is an export, may become taxable later. Something which is taxable today will become an export later. So that is where we will have to actually compare, and we'll do that in the next few slides. We'll have to compare between what the current law is and what the new law is vis-a-vis your specific transaction. And many places you'll see that there are disconnects or changes which are coming out. For example, when you look at transport, today we are saying import consignment, import freight is taxable, export freight is exempted. But when we go to the new regime, we'll see exactly the reverse. We'll see export freight being taxed and import freight being exempted, because the way the supply rule has been drafted is totally different. So we'll come to each of them one by one, and you'll see various opportunities as well as challenges on that. Drawback will continue, but of course it's anyways on a slowly on a phased mode. The rates of drawback might need a realignment, and that is one more policy decision which the foreign trade department will have to take. The DGFT will have to take of whether this duty drawback amount needs to change, reduce, increase. There might be a need for a realignment, because today you have excise which is at an X rate, VAT which is at a Y rate, you have octroi, and all those inefficiencies which are built into your drawback, all of that going away. So we'll have to see how the duty drawback rates get realigned. The concept will stay, but there will be a realignment. The amount might change drastically. The percentages and all will change.
One more thing. If I enter and do a review of service over here,
yes, so that's a big challenge. And you know, you have something which is a contract which lasts for a period which is in the old law and the new law. There's a detailed transition mechanism which we have towards the end of the day we'll be talking about the transition, and certain things they have envisaged, certain things they have not envisaged, and in that session we'll be talking about what all care we will have to take. So I just like to park that question for the time being. We have a detailed session on transition wherein we'll be talking about this issue. Yeah, so there are various exemption schemes both given by the center and the state governments today. So the center government says that if you manufacture in certain areas like Himachal Pradesh and, you know, Assam and northeastern states, there is no excise duty for a 10-year period and all. Now, when GST comes, all of that has to go away. And there's a lot of discussion which is happening that there was a promissory estoppel. You had given us a promise that for the next 10 years, you will not charge me excise duty. I have set up a factory. I would never have come to Assam if you wouldn't have given me this benefit. But the challenge with the government is they cannot give an exemption under GST. That exemption will get nullified at the second level. Today, let us say you are an FMCG manufacturer. you have set up a plant in Assam. Today there is no excise duty because you are set up in that exemption zone. Traders don't need to worry because traders ko excise tha hi nahi aaj bhi. Moving forward, even if they continue exemption for whatever reason, your exemption will get nullified by the trader's CGST liability because the exemption cannot apply to the trader. He was never given an exemption earlier. And that is where the challenge lies. And if they keep everyone out of the net, again the issue is of documentation. The trader will have a soap manufactured by a factory in Assam as well as a factory in Maharashtra. So how are you going to, at a trader level, identify that these goods are goods which are exempted manufactured goods and these are taxable manufactured goods? And people will substitute and there will be a lot of fraud and a possibility of a misuse. So exemption will definitely go away, that looks very clear. As far as the manufacturing units are concerned, they are talking to the government, and maybe what will happen is, like when VAT was introduced, they were converted into what was known as a refund mechanism. So same way you might see some sort of a refund promise to the extent of the least of the excise and the CGST liability, something like that might come out as a special scheme for them. And that too would be like, they will collect the tax on the output side but claim a separate refund from the government, something like that they might bring. So we'll have to just see on that, because that entire exemption rate, they are all pieces which are connected with each other. So at the central level, what they are facing is, there are so many exemptions today, either direct exemptions or product specific exemptions, and if all of them have to go away, everybody is shouting. So somebody who is a garment manufacturer will say that today there is hardly any duty, only above 1000 branded products there is a duty, otherwise there is no duty, VAT also is 5%, if you put me in 18 or 20, I am dead. Same thing jewelry guy says, same thing food product people say, same thing these package scheme guys say. So if all of them continue to be in exemption, 18 is not workable. Then you end up with 24 or 26% rate. Because today the effective rate is 28 to 30. So it's a big trade-off which the governments need to do. And there's a lot of discussions and lots of pulls and pressures which are happening right now on this front. We'll have to see which exemptions, they will be very selective in exemptions. We'll have to see what exemptions they continue. Because that's what will ultimately determine my rate. I hope I'm clear. So if all these tests are satisfied, then we have a zero rating. If they are not satisfied, then there is a concern. What happens? Will you be treating it as an interstate supply or an intrastate supply? And this is going to be very interesting. Let's look at this export of service. We have five conditions. Now let us say I supply a service to a person located in Nepal. Naturally, the place of supply is Nepal, which is outside India. But generally, Nepal pays you in Indian currency. They don't pay you in foreign currency. So I will not be qualifying as an exporter. Supply of service located in India, recipient located outside India, correct. Place of supply is outside India, which is also satisfied. Fourth one is a problem. Payment for such service is received in convertible foreign exchange. So it is not an export of service any longer. So what will I do? Which tax will I pay? I am in Mumbai. My customer is in Nepal. What tax will I pay? IGST. Can you go back to the earlier slides wherein we have defined interstate? First slide, first few slides. What was the definition which we said? Where the location of supplier and the place of supply are in different states. Location of supplier is in Maharashtra. Place of supply is in Nepal, outside India. Can it be IGST? So the same challenge which we talked about for Union Territories will be a challenge here. And therefore, a proposition would be that if the place of supply is located outside India, then maybe it is not an export because I am not satisfying the other four conditions. But that by itself will not end up in me paying a GST liability, because the transaction can still not become an IGST or C plus S GST. It is neither interstate nor intrastate. Yeah, so those laws allow you to do that. Now, certain, of course, that debate is also there to say whether a receipt in Indian currency should be treated as a deemed receipt in foreign currency. That's another line of argument and a discussion which can happen. But for a moment, not even going into that and assuming that I don't satisfy D. For a time being, I agree that I don't satisfy D. Despite that, I don't end up paying a tax. It would still mean that it is not treated as an export and zero rating benefit is not available. But the levy itself is failing. You don't have it as an interstate or an intrastate transaction. And therefore, on these types of transactions, so long as place of supply is outside India, you will not end up paying any GST on that transaction. So we talked about a few points over here. Exports, there is a zero rating, but that zero rating provision is under the SGST Act and not under the IGST Act. It's a technical error. Somewhere they will move it from the S to the IGST Act. Deemed exports, the penultimate sale exemption, second level exemption is no longer available to us. Supplies to SEZ, again a promissory estoppel issue. SEZ units were set up assuming that they will be able to procure goods and services without taxes. But here we now have a situation wherein we are told that the zero rating may no longer continue. As far as EOUs is concerned, it is very clear that the exemption is not going to continue. So that is where we see some challenges. There will be a lot of cash flow issue vis-a-vis the SEZs and the EOUs. So that is on the export part of the transaction. Any specific questions on exports? Should we go to the import area?
Sir, since this GST will have lot of implication on import and export, is the FTP being reworked? Is there any?
Yes, they will have to do that, but they will be a little bit cautious. They will not do it right now. These are all follow-up steps. Once the GST comes into place, they will have to actually estimate the impact, because what happens in FTP is, FTP as a policy is also governed by the international protocols. So when you look at duty drawback, when you look at advanced licensing, we also have to safeguard ourselves from being too ambitious. Okay? If they give you a lot of drawbacks or a lot of concessions under the script, immediately it will be a trigger point for anti-dumping duty in the other state. So therefore, they will have to demonstrate, once this happens, there will be a lot of pressure from international communities to reduce the FTP benefit. Because today, one important reason for FTP benefit is that there is a lot of inefficiency of indirect taxes. The whole idea of duty drawback is to say that today there are so many invisible costs, tax costs, and they give you back those tax costs. And that's how they are able to defend duty drawback. If they are not able to defend it, if they just increase their duty drawback from 100 rupees, assuming for a moment, to 600 rupees. Some commerce minister comes, he feels that I want to increase the duty drawback rate. Next day, the other country will come back and say this 600 has no basis. I want to impose an anti-dumping duty. So what they'll do is, once GST gets implemented, they will again relook at their science. And based on the science, they will look at the tax costs attached and re-notify all these rates, including the script entitlement, EPCG period, all those things will need a relook. But they will wait for maybe for few months for this new scheme to stabilize so that they have some data to back. If they don't have any data to back, again it will be questioned. And data, they can come only after implementation. So we might see some delay in that FTP amendment. Yeah.
Section?
Yeah, import of goods. We'll go to the import, we'll complete imports and then we'll break for lunch. Maybe 10 minutes we'll just talk about imports. Yeah.
Section 251 defines import of goods with its grammatical variation and cognate expression means bringing into India from a place outside India.
Right? Exactly, mirror image of exports. Exports, we said, taking goods from India to outside India. Import is bringing into India from a place outside India.
Section 252 defines import of service. The supply of any service shall be treated as an import of service if A, the supplier of service is located outside India, B, the recipient of service is located in India, C, the place of supply of service is in India, and D, the supplier of service and the recipient of service are not merely establishment of a distinct person. Explanation 1. An establishment of a person in India and any of his other establishment outside India shall be treated as an establishment of a distinct person. Explanation 2. A person carrying on a business through a branch or agency or a representational office in any territorial shall be treated as having an establishment in that territorial.
So here we have a comprehensive definition of import of services. Today also we have a service tax on import of services, we talked about it. Moving forward also importation of services will be reverse charge mechanism. We talked about the first impact, which is free importation getting taxed. When we went into the time of supply, we also talked about the situation of the time being preponed. Now we have a third impact area here. Here we are told the place of supply of services in India. And when we go to the place of supply, we will find that most of the places, if you are a registered person in India, the place of supply becomes India. Today we have many rules which talk about performance based basket and many other event based basket, transportation is a separate rule. All those rules safeguard you from paying a service tax on import of services. Moving forward, most of those rules become redundant and therefore you will end up paying an import of service liability which will be fundamentally higher than what you are paying now. Of course, all of that would be available to you as a credit, but yes, this place of supply of service, which is what we'll be talking of immediately post lunch, is going to be important for analyzing each of your foreign remittances, and you may find quite a few of your foreign remittances may become a subject matter of GST in the moving forward scenario. Clause D is interesting. What we are told is, if there are branches in India and a branch abroad, then the two branches will not be treated as separate establishment for the purposes of import of services. So what essentially it means is, today we have a lot of debate when a company in India remits some money abroad to a branch. The service tax officer say that the remittance is made towards some service provided by the branch to you, so please pay a service tax on import of service. Now luckily that controversy is going away. Even today there are tribunal decisions which say that there is no import of service, the branch does not render a service to the head office. Now that becomes more stronger, and with this clause we don't have to worry about it, that just because I make a remittance abroad, there will be a GST liability. If you make a remittance to a subsidiary, clearly there will be a liability. But if it's only a branch, then that would not be attracting a GST liability. Yes, there will be a GST moving forward. So today, this is one example. I took one example of transportation. Commission is another example. So today what happens is, if there is a commission agent abroad, marketing for a goods of an Indian exporter, as of today he doesn't pay a service tax. There's no service tax on this transaction because the place of supply is overseas. That is how today the law is drafted. However, ulta, an Indian commission agent selling goods of a foreign supplier is required to pay service tax today, which also we discussed earlier. Moving forward, the rule is exactly changing. So what will happen is, when you as an Indian exporter make a remittance abroad, that remittance will be treated as an import of service and there will be a GST liability. But if there is an Indian commission agent who receives commission from a foreign principal, that will be treated as an export of service and there will not be a GST liability. So here we have an exact U-turn from the current provisions of the law in the GST regime. So place of supply rules, that way they are changing drastically in quite a few areas, which we will need to bear in mind. So when you look at imports, import of goods, naturally you are importing through the customs chain and there is a basic custom duty. Along with basic custom duty, the government will charge you an IGST. Today we have a CVD and an SAD. Instead of CVD SAD, there will be an IGST which you will pay along with your bill of entry, and that IGST will enter your credit mechanism and immediately available to you as a credit. Sale in the course of import and high seas is a big challenge which we will face today. These transactions happen before the goods cross the Indian frontier, and therefore under CST law there is no tax on this transaction. Moving forward, because the supplier is in India and the recipient is in India, there will be an IGST on that transaction. Over and above that, when the buyer goes to the customs authorities and clears the goods, there will be one more layer of IGST. And therefore actually what will happen is, this high seas and sequoia transactions will become unviable. You will have a two layer IGST, both of them available as a credit to the end buyer, but there will be two layers of IGST which will happen. So that is a challenge which one will have to look at when one looks at import of goods and high seas sales. So high seas, more or less we have been talking about this to industry, and more or less the thought process is, if this be the situation, we will not do high seas, because one of the most important rationale for high seas was the VAT exemption which was existing today. If that VAT exemption is anywhere going to go away and credits are going to be available across the board, then maybe we'll avoid entering into HICs and just do a normal transaction in a normal fashion. And import of services we were talked about. Of course, one important analogy which is coming out is, as of today in service tax, Jammu and Kashmir service tax law does not apply as of today. Second aspect is excise, there's an exemption for Jammu and Kashmir. Moving forward, Jammu and Kashmir, at least GST law proclaims it to be a part of India. And therefore, GST would apply to Jammu and Kashmir as well. The state finance minister in an interview had raised serious objections to this. But beyond that, nothing has happened. The constitutional amendment bill has been ratified. So as of today, GST applies to the state of Jammu and Kashmir as well. So if you make remittances to a Kashmir service provider, today you are required to pay import of service tax. Moving forward, that goes away. So remittances to Jammu and Kashmir will not attract a reverse charge mechanism moving forward. Of course, supplies to Jammu and Kashmir also will no longer be exempted. So that is a ripple effect of this Jammu and Kashmir becoming a part of the GST territory of India.